Good morning.
Flippin' physics.
Let's determine the electric field caused by a uniformly charged ring of charge positive Q with radius A at point P, which is located on the axis of the ring, a distance X from the center of the ring. Basically, we have a positively charged object which looks remarkably like a roll of tape. However, realize the width and thickness of the roll of tape are very, very small relative to its radius. What you see in this illustration is a side view cross section of the ring. In other words, you are seeing the ring from the side, and it is as though we have cut the ring vertically in the middle, and the gray areas in the illustration show the inside of the thin ring. Our known values are A, the radius of the ring, X, the distance from the center of the ring to the point P, which, again, for symmetry purposes, is along the axis of the ring, and capital Q, the total positive charge on the ring. We are going to break our ring into infinitesimally small charges dQ, which you can see I have illustrated in the front view of our uniformly charged thin ring. Let's see if the three of you can solve for the electric field at point P.
All three of us?
Yep, all three of you.
Okay. Well, we can start with the equation for the electric field caused by a continuous charge distribution, which we used before.
Right, but the problem is that the direction of the electric field at point P is not the same for every charge dQ on the ring.
Then we need to look at dE, the electric field caused by every dQ, which equals the Coulomb constant times dQ over r squared, all times unit vector r. If we put a small positive test charge at point P, then the direction of dE, the electric field caused by the charge dQ, Mr. P illustrated in the illustration, is down and to the right. And the hypotenuse of the right triangle is r. That means that according to the Pythagorean theorem, we can substitute a squared plus x squared in for r squared.
And we can break dE into components in the x and y directions. When we do that, you can see that for every dQ on one side of the ring, there is a dQ on the opposite side of the ring such that their components of the electric field dE in the y direction cancel one another out. That means all the components of dE in the y direction cancel out, and the total electric field caused by the ring at point P is only in the positive x direction.
And we can define theta in both of the similar triangles, such that because cosine equals adjacent over hypotenuse, dE in the x direction equals dE times the cosine of theta. And we can substitute the equation we got for dE into this equation for dE in the x direction, and take the integral of both sides to get the total electric field at point P equals the integral of the Coulomb constant over a squared plus x squared, all times unit vector r, times cosine theta, all with respect to charge. Actually, instead of unit vector r, we can substitute in unit vector I, because we already determined the electric field caused by the ring at point P is to the right.
And that is what Mr. P meant by us only being responsible for electric fields at specific points, which are mathematically easier due to symmetry. If point P were not along the axis of the ring, the electric field from every dQ would not have the same magnitude, and all the electric fields in the y direction would not cancel out. It would be much more difficult to calculate the electric field there.
Exactly. Please keep going.
Again, we can use cosine theta, which equals adjacent over hypotenuse, but it also equals x over r. And again, using the Pythagorean theorem, we know r equals the square root of a squared plus x squared, and we can substitute that back into our equation for cosine theta.
In the denominator, the quantity a squared plus x squared times the square root of a squared plus x squared equals the quantity a squared plus x squared to the 3/2 power.
At this point, there is nothing left under the integral, which is a variable.
What?
Look at it. For every dQ on the ring, A is constant, X is constant, And the Coulomb constant and unit vector I are both constants, so all of that comes out from under the integral.
Yeah, sure. But x is constant? Isn't x a variable horizontal distance from the center of the ring to point P?
For every dq on the ring, x has the same value. Therefore, x is a constant for the integral.
Yeah, thanks.
And the integral of dq is just capital Q, the charge on the ring. We just solved for the electric field at point P caused by the uniformly charged ring. It equals the quantity, the Coulomb constant, times the charge on the ring times the horizontal distance to point P, all divided by the quantity, the square of the radius of the ring plus the square of the horizontal distance to point P, that quantity raised to the 3/2 power, all times unit vector I.
Wow. Yeah. Right. But do you see it?
See what?
If x is much, much larger than a, then a squared plus x squared is roughly equal to x squared. Substitute x squared into that equation instead of a squared plus x squared, and you get x cubed on the bottom. However, one of the x's cancels out on the top and the bottom, and you get that the electric field at point P, when x is much, much larger than a, is roughly equal to the quantity, the Coulomb constant, times the charge on the ring, all over x squared, all times unit vector I. It acts like a point charge.
Yes, it acts like a point charge. This is always true. The farther you get from a finite continuous charge distribution, the more the electric field caused by the continuous charge distribution matches the electric field caused by a point charge. But Bobby, what if x is much, much smaller than a?
If x is much, much smaller than a, then a squared plus x squared is roughly equal to a squared. I guess we could then, in the electric field equation, change the parenthetical expression in the denominator to a squared. A squared to the 3/2 power is a cubed, so we get a new expression for the electric field at point P. However, I'm not sure what the point of that is.
Bobby, I can see how that might not be clear just yet. Give me a bit. Now, what if we were to place a negative point charge, little q, a small distance to the right of the center of the ring along the axis of the ring? Class, in what direction would the small negative charge q experience an electrostatic force?
To the left?
Yeah, to the left.
Sure, toward the center of the ring.
We could then sum the forces in the x direction on the small negative charge. That equals the negative of the electrostatic force because it is to the left. And the net force equals mass times acceleration in the x direction. The electric force equals the magnitude of the small negative charge q times the electric field. We can substitute the equation Bobby just solved for in the electric field, and then we can solve for the acceleration in the x direction of little q. Class, do you see anything familiar?
I do not.
Okay, let me take it one more step. We know the acceleration in the x direction is the second derivative of x position with respect to time.
Oh no, you've got to be kidding me.
What?
Yeah, what?
The negative point charge moves in simple harmonic motion.
Wow!
Whoa.
Yeah.
It is right there. The equation condition for simple harmonic motion is that the second derivative of position with respect to time equals the negative of the square of angular frequency times position. That means the angular frequency of the negative point charge equals the square root of the Coulomb constant times the magnitude of the charge of the small negative charge times the charge of the ring, all divided by the mass of the small negative charge times the cube of the radius of the ring.
And angular frequency equals 2 pi over period, which means the period of the simple harmonic motion of the small negative charge equals 2 pi times the square root of the mass of the small charge times a cubed all over the Coulomb constant times little q times big q.
Simple harmonic motion. I cannot believe we have to remember how to derive all of those equations.
Oh yes, you certainly do. Please, realize you need to remember everything from mechanics. Electricity and magnetism continues to build on everything you have learned before. It is awesome.
It is awesome.
Yeah.
Sure.
We could even bring in the equations for position, velocity, and acceleration as functions of time for simple harmonic motion, which we solved for when we studied mechanics.
Fun.
Yeah.
That is even more awesome.
Yes. Yes, it is. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.